proprietary tool for OBE implementation, Juno. I take this opportunity to introduce our expert speaker, Dr. Arpita Gopal. Dr. Arpita Gopal has completed PhD in computer science. I request the others to mute the mic if possible. Yeah, Dr. Arpita Gopal has... Hello?
Yeah, ma'am, we can hear you.
Yes. Dr. Arpita Gopal has completed PhD in computer science. Dr. Arpita Gopal is co-founder and director at Juno Software Systems Private Limited for GEMS, Governing Education Management System. She won the NASSCOM Social Innovation Honor 2014 in the individual or group category. The award was handed over by Raghuram Rajan, Governor of Reserve Bank of India. She also won Frost and Sullivan India ICT Award, Product Innovation Leadership Enterprise Application for 2014. Other awards she won include IBM Global Entrepreneur Program for Cloud Startup, Women Entrepreneurship Quest Top 6, Winners for the Hot 100 Awards 2015. She has extensive experience of 17 years in academics on various roles, teaching, administration, placements, corporate relations, part of management, and also on bodies of university and compliance bodies. Ma'am is the author of Hospital Management System, SOAP, Node Online. She has published various papers in journals and conferences, including IEEE, and is editor and chief editor on various research journals. Ma'am has also guided PhD students. She has published several textbooks and reference books in computer science and IT with PHI and other publications. She has been on board of studies for various course curriculum, paper setter, and examiner for SET, PhD entrance exam, etc. On various committees for syllabus setting, revision, university inquiry committees, staff selection committees, etc. Ma'am is also a resource person on various forums. She is gold medalist with 81.6%. I welcome you, madam, to this session.
Thank you so much, ma'am. And even I keep wondering why you're introducing, because it's a very generous introduction, and thank you so much for the same. So, yeah. So how I plan to do it today is, what I'll do is, I will just give a very, my introduction is already in place. So what I'm trying to do is, I'm just trying to give a very small presentation on what are we thinking in terms of outcome-based education, and where do we go, what do we do to measure it properly, and how does it work? And then what I'll do, we have actually a ERP, full-fledged ERP solution, where one of the modules is assisted by OBE. So I will try to demonstrate that to give you a practical outlook of how things can be achieved using this outcome-based education. So I hope it's okay with everyone. And if there is any question, I would love to welcome those questions at the end of this discussion also. And if the viewers need something in between, then I'm okay that way too. So, in my introduction, it was stated that I have spent a lot of years in academics, and I actually have around 18 years. And I was at various positions. I was a teacher, I was an assistant professor, a professor, an associate professor. I did my PhD, then I was a director of a management institution. So I have done teaching, and I was associated in a management institution, although I was a professor for MCA. And I also took some engineering classes. So I do understand the teaching, what happens in engineering and in management institutions. And at the time that we were teaching, there were programs, and then there were subjects within the programs. Now the terminology has changed and the subjects are called essentially courses, and hence the course file and the course outcomes. So there were courses and teachers were teaching their courses. And of course, teachers were doing concurrent evaluation. And at the end of the term, there was final evaluation. And the students were passing and getting placed. But what was missing in this whole process was probably something that is stitching everything together. So there were programs, within the programs, syllabus patterns, within the syllabus patterns, courses, teaching was happening, assessment was happening, students were qualifying, students were getting placed. But a very close connect between all these steps that I told you was missing. And outcome-based education actually aims at stitching everything together by the means of a feedback mechanism. So it actually creates a very production line style mechanical structure for all these programs. So it's kind of an attempt to quantify this service-based industry as how things happen on a production line. So what happens on a production line? There is input, the input is processed, and then there is output. So here, the input is recognized as the faculties that have been appointed by the institution, the curriculum which is on offer, the infrastructure, the laboratories, other resources which we give as an input. What is the process? Process is interaction with the students in the form of teaching or laboratory sessions or tutorials or whatever interactions the teachers do with the students. They teach them and then also they try to assess them. Assessment could be in a concurrent assessment manner, or it could be as a final assessment. So the result that at time that I was teaching, the result was students graduated and they got placed. Same results for outcome-based education also. The only thing is, from the output, from the result, they're tying it back to the input by the way of feedback. Now, feedback on basis of what? So what do they say is that the reason that we are doing all this is that the stakeholder satisfaction level has to be achieved. Now, who are the stakeholders in an education setup? So the stakeholders in an education setup are employers. I hope my screen is visible, is it?
Ma'am, are you sharing some PPT?
No, ma'am. 1 minute.
There is no PPT that is shared.
1 minute. Let me just do the needful. So I can present.
Yes, yes.
I will join again, ma'am, because I was on Mozilla and that is not allowing me to share my PPT.
Okay.
So I'm joining through Chrome, yes, and then sharing.
Yes, fine, ma'am. Now the screen is visible, ma'am. Ma'am, I think you're muted.
No. Madam, you are audible, madam.
Now is it okay? Yeah, okay.
Yes.
So what this outcome-based education aims at doing is, it wants to tie the three processes together by the way of feedback from the end result. So what form of feedback? So feedback will be in terms of the satisfaction level of the stakeholders. Who are the stakeholders? What are we giving? Suppose we are talking of an engineering college. What are we giving as an output? So we are giving graduates. What attributes should the graduate possess when he qualifies as a graduate engineer? So the attributes that he can possess is he should be employable. He should be a responsible citizen. He should be able to solve business problems. He should have a domain understanding of all possible departments in an organization. So those could be the desirable results in terms of an employer. Then there could be some desirable results in terms of parents. So parents are investing fees. So they want some return. So maybe they want their ward to earn something, earn a decent salary. What about the public? So public perception could be that, yeah, it's a graduate engineer. He should be morally responsible. He should not be doing things which would result in pollution. So if he's working in an industry, he should learn how to control the pollution resulting out of the production line, etc. So various stakeholders' desires have to be understood and have to be mapped whether we are able to meet those desirable results that the stakeholders are perceiving out of the students who are graduating after studying this program. And depending upon how much of satisfaction they can derive, we will be either changing the faculties or curriculum or the resources or the teaching and learning method. So the feedback directly goes and tries to make changes either in the input or the processes. So when everything ties together, so the whole outlook of outcome-based education, see, it's kind of that of a production line. We give input, there is a process, we give output, we take a feedback, we either change the input or we change a process. Again, we check the output, match it against the qualifying criteria. Again, we change the input and it's an iterative process. So they are trying to mechanize it. They're trying to quantify it. They're trying to see whether every aspect of teaching learning, can it be measured? Can it be quantified? Can it be improved? Can we derive some decisions out of it? That is the difference between traditional education versus outcome-based education. So the only thing missing when we were doing it was more of qualitative. It was like, okay, aaj faculty ka tabiyat theek nahi hai. The faculty did not take a session. Or, okay, the faculty can take a session tomorrow. Maybe the faculty will ask the students to present a few topics and cover the syllabus like that. The consciousness in terms of quantifying each and every smallest deliverable, like each session matters, whether it has been delivered properly, whether the students are able to analyze what was taught to them, they are able to understand, they are able to apply the knowledge which was delivered in that particular session and build a model out of it. Are they able to apply, are they conscious of the application of the concepts which are taught to them in the class? This is what they are trying to achieve in outcome-based education. So they are trying to focus on the short-term goals and on the long-term goals. And they are trying to judge everything with respect to the stakeholder satisfaction, which could be employers and industry advisors and academic staff and public and parents and students and alumni or anybody else. Maybe the government, anybody who's in the environment, who's receiving this output result, the graduate engineers, and interacting with them in some or the other form. And then they're trying to make some changes here, either here or here. Also, more conscious efforts are now put in quantifying every course that is included as a part of a program. So there has to be a justification of everything. Why are you running that program? What are the objectives? What do you want to achieve? Okay, suppose this is the objective that you're running this program. Then what is the syllabus of this program? Which are the courses that you're teaching? Why are you teaching a particular course? Everything is questioned. Why are you teaching a particular course? So, okay, this course is being taught because this course will result into achieving this program objective and that program objective. Then for each course, how are you teaching it? Is the teacher taking a session, or is it through case studies, or is it through laboratories, or is it through discussion? How are you doing the assessment as to whatever you taught is learnt by the student, is grasped by the student? So all the assessments, and then relating every assessment to, does this assessment help in understanding whether the students have understood the concept? So they also define outcomes, specific objectives for the course. And they try to judge from these assessments that are happening, are they able to achieve the objectives of the course? And in turn, are they able to achieve the objectives of the program? So the measurement of how effective is the delivery of the course is not only through this assessment that I'm talking about, the concurrent and the final assessment, but also through other methods like feedbacks, like talking to various people, like looking at the placements and other things. So this direct assessment and the indirect assessment, and whether the course objectives have been achieved and the program objectives have been achieved, all this quantification process is actually known as outcome-based education. So everything remains the same as the traditional education. Only thing is many more clearly stated objectives and many more methods of identifying whether the objectives have been achieved, how many objectives have been achieved, what is the satisfaction level of the stakeholders. And if you are missing somewhere, then improve it. Or else if everything is 100%, like the satisfaction level of the stakeholders is 100%, that means your program objectives are stated very low quality. That is why everything is achieved already. So better change the program objectives and change the course objectives. So it's a continuous cycle, never-ending cycle of feedback, correction, which is embedded in the traditional way of teaching, which is shown in this particular block, which translates as outcome-based education. Now, this is a better way of saying, now I'm only concentrating on the new methodology of teaching, that is through outcome-based education rather than traditional methodology of teaching. And if I talk about my personal experience, then look at the contrast. While I was in teaching line, I was only doing traditional teaching. In the last few years, actually, we got introduced to OBE. And when I came into software, I had to develop a tool to measure everything. Whatever the faculties do, how they do, everything to be measured. So now, if you remember, if the faculties who are attending, if they remember, and if they faced any NAC or any NBA kind of accreditation body, then you know that it's mandatory for these bodies that the institutions has a stated vision and mission and short-term goal and long-term goal and quality statement. So these things are anyways mandatory, and that was mandatory in the traditional teaching also. And same way, we need to define the mission, vision, short-term, long-term objectives, etc. for a particular program also. So OBE is trying the teaching learning methodology and the quantification of the teaching learning methodology along with the feedback of the stakeholders to the mission, vision of the program. So everything starts from defining a vision and mission statement of the institute and the program, and defining why are we running this program? What are the objectives that we are trying to achieve? So program educational objectives are the broader objectives that we are trying to achieve. And the program outcomes are the narrow objectives. Exactly what do we want to? So suppose I say I want to, I want to produce, my outcome will be a computer engineer. So is computer engineer sufficient? Like if he knows programming languages and if he knows hardware, should he not know any domain? If he doesn't know any domain, how is he going to apply the computer knowledge in different departments in the company? So what is also needed for a computer engineer graduate is not only the hardware understanding and the software understanding, but the various domain, functional domain understanding of an organization. So depending upon
you know, depending upon what the institution specializes in, like some institutions are research oriented, some institutions are social, social contribution oriented, some institutions are very, very professional, they give high degree of placement. So institutions vary in their pursuit. That is how they define the program outcomes. So some people are more into that, they want their graduate attributes to go more into research and invent new things and go for innovation. Some other institutions will be very, very conscious that their students should get placed. Placement numbers should be good. Some other institutions could be, no. Placement is okay. Don't want my students to work for other people. Let them be entrepreneurs. So creativity is more important. Developing your own model. So depending upon what type of an institution is, they define narrower objectives in terms of program outcomes. Now what is a program formed of? So program is formed of multiple terms. Terms could be an annual semester, or it could be a trimester, or it could be a annual pattern or semester or trimester within which courses are taught. Different types of courses, core courses and audit courses and elective courses. So for all these courses, why are the courses a part of a program? Why should this particular course be taught in this program? What are the objectives of the course? So that the objectives of the course relate to the program objectives. And if I attain the objectives of the course, it partly attains the program objectives. If I attain all the course objectives of all the courses, then it will, to a level, help me achieving the program objectives. So then learning outcomes of every course needs to be defined. So this particular vision, mission, program, educational objectives, program outcomes, learning outcomes, I have not done the complete hierarchy because I missed out on the assessment part. How is a course delivered to the students? That part I have not finished here. I will spell that out. Why didn't I do it? Because I just wanted to divide these things into long-term outcomes and short-term outcomes. And to this, if this is embedded by a continuous improvement cycle, continuous quality improvement. So everything needs to be stated. Why are we running this program? How is it important? With respect to the people who take placements, so that means industry or industry expert, to the parents who are investing the fee, maybe we make their ward capable of earning, to the society, so their life quality will better because this particular engineer will develop something or will help a big company develop something so that, you know, diabetes test would be as simple as pricking on your own sitting at home rather than taking a leave, going to the hospital, getting your sugar level judged, wasting 24 hours to do that. So an engineer made it possible to have a simplified version of sugar level measurement just by pricking a needle and reading the output. So society is also bothered that they need engineers who can innovate more, who have more entrepreneurial characteristics. So that means everything needs to be stated. What do you want? Say that. What is that? What is the mission and vision of the institution? And whatever you're saying, that this is what you want, are you doing the exact same thing to achieve that so that your students could achieve it? If yes, prove it. How do you prove it? Well, what I'm trying to do is I'm trying to make engineers to do this. Who will validate that I have done this? So the stakeholders will validate it. The parents will validate. The industry will validate. The society will validate. Whether my engineers are so poor in quality that they are increasing the environmental pollution, or no, they are helping us control that. And proof, you can't prove anything 100%. Like, everything is not like black and white. It's in gray shades. So whatever is in gray, try to improve it. That's what is embedded in the traditional teaching to make it quantifiable, to make it outcome-based. So here, the level that I have missed is, after defining the learning outcomes of the courses, how is the course delivered? Where course is delivered by teaching, How do you judge whether your teaching is effective? By the way of assessment and by the way of feedback. So any kind of assessment that we perform, if we measure it, we call it measurement through direct attainment through direct assessment. And if we measure it through the feedback, we call it attainment through indirect assessment. So whether the outcomes have been achieved or not are measured in two different ways. Measurement of attainment through direct assessment, measurement of attainment through indirect assessment. When we measure through direct assessment, we include concurrent assessment methods and we include final assessment. And when we talk about indirect assessment methods, we talk of feedback. So what do we do for assessment? Well, we give assignments, we give case studies, we give class participation, we give presentations, we give online tests, etc. So every question that you're including in an assignment, every question that you're including in an online test, or in a case study, or in a presentation, how does it relate to the course outcome? Why is the question there in the assessment? Unless it helps me attaining some course outcome. So suppose I relate this particular question, which I have included in the assignment, to three possible course outcomes. Course outcome CO1, CO2, CO4. How many students have gathered enough courage to attempt that particular question? And how have they scored? That complex equation will give me an understanding of whether this question was justified in the assessment. And if yes, how much of course outcome attainment am I able to achieve? That means suppose only 50% student attempted that particular question. And the average score is, let's say, 60%. So there's some formula that will determine, okay, course outcome one has been attained this percentage. Course outcome two has been attained this percentage. Course outcome four has been attained this percentage. And cumulative accumulation of all this calculation will tell me whether the course outcome for this particular course is how much of that was above the satisfaction level, how much of that was below the satisfaction level. And the course outcome calculation in turn will allow me calculating the attainment of the program outcome. This, whatever we are talking, is through the direct assessment. So again, whatever I said is depicted in the form of a diagram. The program objectives, the broader statements, the program outcomes, the narrower statements, the learning outcomes of the courses. So LOs, some people define LOs, some people define COs. It's one and the same thing, course outcome or learning outcome. Well, how do you measure that? Through assessment. Different assessments. Assessments could be a list of them. I mean, people have balanced scorecard performance and people have case studies and some people include attendance and class participation and presentation. And I mean, it could be X, Y, Z. Yeah, program outcomes can also be measured through indirect assessment by the way of feedback. And all of this calculation of this learning outcomes of courses will in turn result in calculation of the program outcomes and the program objectives. And everywhere we have to analyze, and this is continuous quality improvement, either change this, either change the course outcomes or change the teaching method or change the assessment, mostly it is that only, or change the definition of the program outcomes, or change the definition of program objectives. So this continuous cyclic nature of feedback is what is important in OBE. So you have to justify something. Like suppose if NBA comes and NAC comes, you can't simply say, no, sir, our satisfaction level of attainment is 90% above. Then he will say, that means your program outcomes are not are substandard, below standard. Your program objectives is below standard. You have not defined it properly. So that is what the answer of the committee would be. So we can't simply say that we have achieved this satisfaction level. That is not done with them. If we have achieved, then what next? What are you thinking? Maybe then you have to give harder assessments. Or maybe that you have to change the complexity of courses that you have included in the program. Or maybe you have to have less friendlier teachers. Some analysis and improvement points you have to tell to these committees so that they know that you know what is lacking, what is very fluidly defined, what is substandard or above standard. Suppose satisfaction level is very low. Then either teaching is taken very lightly or the students are not of good quality, so they will check the admission indexes. Which are the meritless students who are taking admission in this institution? Why are the meritorious students not coming in this particular institution? Or if merit list or rank is also high and the teaching standards are good and the attendance is good and then also the satisfaction level is high, that means we are giving really, really tough assessments. So teaching can be bettered. Not that we lower the standards of program outcomes and objectives. Teaching needs to be bettered so that students understand more, they attempt the assessments in a better manner and score better. Some effort to help them score better. This is the checklist for OBE. This is how all of this should be defined for the OBE to happen. Graduate attributes. Suppose you are producing, what is your product? What is your end result of your production line? Is it a management graduate? Or is it an engineering graduate? Or is it a research scholar, PhD holder? Define that first of all. What is the mission and the vision of the program? Of course, above that, you have to define it for the institution also. What are the long-term goals? What are the broader objectives? What are the narrower ones, the short-term goals? Which courses are a part of this program? Why have you kept this particular course, which is so important, as elective? Why not as a core course? Are you creating a specialization out of this? If no, then make it a core course. What are the course outcomes defined? How do the course outcomes and the program outcomes map with each other? Which course outcomes help us in attaining these program outcomes? So that way we make the matrix. What are the assessment parameters? How do we assess each course? How do we teach and assess each course? How does the assessment happen? Is it an open book or it's a closed book or it's always in writing, whether it's objective or subjective, etc. And then feedback, closing the loop by checking health of evaluation, teaching methods, course curriculum, program curriculum. Change anything if whatever you think the feedback indicates. So this is actually in total what do we do in outcome-based education. I have not given a lot of space in my PPT for indirect assessment, for feedbacks, but that is also considered very, very important. And if you talk of NBA and if you talk of NAC, they have defined levels of feedback. That is helpful in calculating the indirect assessment for the attainment of stakeholders' objectives, stakeholder satisfaction. So feedback is normally, people, when I talk of feedback, people think of teaching feedback, course feedback, faculty feedback. But there are many other type of feedbacks, like whether you have proper infrastructure or if the cleaning is kept done properly, do the students feel healthy sitting in the classroom, or there is dust everywhere and it's not properly ventilated, are the hostel facilities good, is the exam office good, courteous enough, is the admission office good, Is the transport facility, library, is it full of good books? Are the students encouraged to attend the library? Does it look lively? All possible feedbacks. Next level of feedback is a grievance addressal system, which now AICT has mandated that there should be a proper grievance addressal system both for employees and for students. And when a student registers his grievance, a proper board, a committee should address it and decide whether it needs escalation. And resolution should be in a well-defined time up to the satisfaction of the person who raised the grievance. And another level above this grievance addressal mechanism is RTI, the right to information. So which is actually goes legal. So indirect assessment is in multiple forms. Only the feedback part, feedback all around, 360 degree feedback is included in calculation of the OB. But AICT, NBA, NAC, everybody gives high importance to grievance addressal mechanism also. So now, if there is any question in this, I mean, I will invite the audience to ask me, or else I will show you what do we do in our tool and how do we measure and calculate any of these.
Yes, madam, I think we can take some questions from the audience.
Yeah, why not?
Rita, madam.
I will show
request the participants also. If there is any question, you can unmute and please ask the question.
Please, yeah.
Very experienced, and we can use the experience to clarify our doubts.
Ma'am, I'm just learning with everybody, so yeah, but I will try my best to answer the questions.
Your diverse experience is very helpful, ma'am. Different fields.
yeah, I do.
Yeah, at the same time, you have academic experience also.
Yeah.
So, I mean, we generally don't get such a combination, like yeah. Industry.
Thank you so much.
Yes, ma'am. So, like, madam, when we plan the activity for attainment of course outcomes. So basically, can few teachers come together and have that activity, and then map those activities there to their COs? I mean, and how to do it in the tool like that?
Sure. Yes. So you said it right. So now here I will try to explain the two contrasts that we are having. So we have institutions where everything related to academics is very strictly and centrally controlled by the APO. APO is Academic Program Office. That means we have dean, and then we have head of the departments, and then we have an APO set up which determines which particular course should be allocated to which particular faculty for teaching. Although even in such institutions where things are very centrally controlled and strict, they do take choices from the faculty as to their course preferences. But the decision is made on several other factors, like what was their earlier feedback, what was the average attendance, any special comments that the students have given in the feedback, what was the result of the faculty, if the same faculty has taught the course earlier. Multiple parameters are taken into consideration. And then the course teacher allocation is done by the APO. They form formal boards, like board of studies, they form formal boards which define elaborate course outcomes and also give a proper metrics of relationship between the course outcomes and the program outcomes. Now, when a course is delegated to a faculty, suppose the course is delegated to me and a board of studies have already decided the course outcomes and already decided how it relates to the program outcome. However, the course is given to teach not 100% of the syllabus. Let's say 30% of the syllabus. And another faculty has been given 70% of the syllabus to teach. So I have the liberty, I will have a course file, the other faculty will also have a course file. I have the liberty to define some small subset of my own course outcome and teaching methods that I will take this 30% of the course that has been allocated to me by the way of case studies or by the way of laboratory experiments or by the way of field studies or by the way of presentations. And I'm going to relate to now this 30% of the syllabus that I'm going to cover doesn't relate to all the six COs that have been defined by the Board of Studies. I will be able to relate to only two COs, because I'm only looking at the practical aspect of implementing whatever is being taught in this particular course. The other faculty who has been given 70% of the syllabus can relate to all the six COs, or can relate to the four COs out of the six COs, and can also define subset of COs. So that can be configured in the solution also, and is done practically also. And then both the teachers will have their own independent course files. They will have their own set of syllabus portions to teach. They will have their own set of learning notes, teaching notes, assignments. They can have different evaluation parameters, like this one chooses more of case studies and presentations. The other one chooses more of assignments and online tests, because she's teaching the theory part and this one is teaching the practical part. That is possible. And in architectural courses, what does happen is one particular course is given to two faculties to teach, and they share a course file. Both of them are doing 100% of the syllabus. Only they're dividing the whole class into small sections, like four groups, and one is handling two groups and another is handling two groups. They are sharing the same thread of teaching. So maybe they can define on the same set of evaluation parameters, or a superset where this one will be doing three evaluation parameters and this one will be taking care of other two evaluation parameters. They can share the course file. So that is what happens in some of the institutions. In contrast, I have seen institutions where the Board of Studies only limits themselves to decide the program outcomes and the courses which will be included in the program and the credits of the courses. And then they do the teacher course allocation, and everything else is delegated to the teacher level. So the teachers decide on their course outcomes on their own. The teachers relate the course outcome, how does it contribute to the program outcome. Teacher decides on the evaluation parameters. So teacher will be, you know, responsible for owning up that particular course and doing justice to it, and also quantifying how does it help in attaining, contributing to at least a subset of the program outcomes. Everything is delegated. So the solution that I will be showing you, the practical thing, will facilitate either or configuration. Now, how much to centrally control, or how much to delegate, or whether to delegate completely, but the delegation is monitored by a central committee, all of that is configurable and is decided and differs from institution to institution. So it depends. So I hope I'm able to answer your question.
Thanks for your elaborative explanation. Thank you so much.
Thank you. So I will show, how it is done in this setup.
Yes.
I forgot to mention something, so which I will quickly mention, and then I'll come back to the actual demonstration. So there is one thread that I actually did not mention. That thread is two threads, actually. So I will just write down those threads and also show you how does these things happen. One is, what are the assessment methods that needs to be taken into consideration when I am teaching various courses which are included in the syllabus of a program. So as I told you, direct assessments, I have just mentioned very few. So normally these are known as evaluation parameters. They define a master list of evaluation parameters. That these are the methods in which concurrent evaluation and the final evaluation can be done. And faculties are free to choose any subset of these evaluation parameters for evaluating their particular course. And ditto for indirect assessment. They give a superset, and then a subset of it is used. Also, for most of them, achievement levels are defined. Now, this is just a very vague example that I have quoted, which I will show you properly when I'm giving you the live demo. But somewhere like a rubrics level of 3, level 1, level 2, level 3. So if level 1 attainment has been achieved, that means 33% satisfaction level. Level 2, 66% satisfaction level. Level 3, above 80% satisfaction level. So it's possible to have like 3 levels or 5 levels or 7 levels. How much level of quantification, whether it's a broad quantification matrix or it's a very narrow quantification matrix, can be decided by the institution and differs from institution to institution. I have actually kind of, I deal with around 260 different setups, trusts. And in each trust, there are multiple institutions. So around 300 different institutions. And majority of them follow at least the three level of metrics. 33%, 60%, above 85%. Some also have five different levels of calculating. So it's like that for that fan regulator, we earlier had this 1, 2, 3, and now we have an analog regulator where you can like 0.1, 0.2, you can decide the speed of the fan very, very minutely. So it depends upon how you want to, how much you want to actually narrow it down. So this achievement levels, rubrics ranges can be defined. And the other important thing which I forgot to mention is the Bloomberg's taxonomy. So the Bloomberg's taxonomy is another attempt at understanding what is done in this particular program in terms of course delivery and assessment, and where is it going heavier and where is it it being missed. Like, for example, I've seen some institutions where question papers, everything will be, please explain in brief or please explain in detail. So the questions related to create a model, do a comparative analysis, do a critical analysis, like analyze type questions or create model type questions are very, very less. Everything is explain in detail, explain in brief. Write short notes. So write short notes is what? Explain in brief. Elaborate is what? Explain in detail. So they apply Bloomberg's taxonomy intelligence to judge what is being taught. Is it only theoretical? If everything is explain, then only theoretical teaching is going on. Is it creation of a model? Is it application of knowledge to create some practical, live thing? Or is it a comparative analysis? Is it critical analysis? Is it an empirical analysis? What kind of analysis is being done? So they judge. So what happens is program, and then we have courses. So within the courses, we have chapters. Within the chapters, we have topics and subtopics. So they actually check when we define the subtopics and topics of a course, they check how many times explain word is being used, how many times analyze word is being used, how many times create a model word is being used. So different taxonomies are decided that for an engineering program, this is an ideal mix. For a management program, this is an ideal mix. For an architect, it should not be explain or analyze. It should be create a model, mostly create a model. It should be heavy on create a model. For a management, for an HR person, HR MBA, it should be more of analyze the performance of a candidate. So what is heavy? What is the orientation of teaching for a particular program and what is desired? They compare, and then if it's a good tool, it will suggest that teachers should more be, should be more practical oriented. They should give more emphasis on comparative analysis or creation of models rather than explaining and detailing. So there's some suggestions come out of that too. So it's only like drilling down what teaching method, what teaching content, what teaching topics, subtopics, assessment is being given to the students, and whether they are being groomed in the right direction or they're only being groomed for theory and not enough for practical. So that is what actually I had missed, and I will show you now how it can be done in this program. So first of all, this thing that I'm showing you here is one example of taxonomy. Like, I want to judge if I'm encouraging students to remember more or understand more or apply the knowledge that they've understood or do an analysis, could be any analysis, or evaluate the outcome or evaluate the result of something or create. Does my course and my program require more of creation or analysis or only remembering? Is remembering enough? So here, suppose I'm running a medical course. So yeah, remembering and applying is most important. I should apply my knowledge in the prescription, and I should see the result. If it's an architectural course, creating, utmost important. So this is just one example of the taxonomy that I have taken up. And this taxonomy can be linked to the definitions of the PO, definitions of the CO, definitions of the chapters, topics, subtopics, all the questions which are appearing in the assignments or in the online tests, everywhere you the scanner can scan which of the taxonomies are used the most. 70% time it's explain or remember. 20% time it's analyze. 10% time it's either evaluate or create. How should it be ideally? So it can be done in that manner. But anyway, I mean, this is just a sample data that I'm trying to show you. So here I'm just showing you the program, outcomes that have been defined. I will show you another configuration also where program educational objectives have also been defined. So it states problem analysis and decision-making skill. Identify, formulate, analyze problems, reaching substantiated conclusions using different techniques of mathematics, finance, and modern management subjects. This is one graduate attribute that my engineer should possess after he qualifies the program that I'm offering. And then I also want him to possess managerial and business competency. Demonstrate knowledge and understanding of the management concepts and apply these to your own work and lead the team. So he should have leading capabilities. He should be good at communication and interaction. And he should be also conscious, he should be a responsible citizen, not pollute the environment, behave, have some moral responsibilities. He should be a civilized, he should be having a civilized behavior. Cannot act as a student, drunk and, dancing on the road. The program outcomes can be extreme to a very, very, environmental, how I should behave in this society, or to how I should behave in an organization. What skill sets should I possess? What should I be able to solve? How should I be able to apply the knowledge and the basic understanding that I've learned in this particular program for the betterment of the company? So these could be the sample program outcomes. So these I have not defined. I'm just showing you one instance which has been defined. And it looks more to me like a management program. If it's an engineering program, it will be very different. Now, for each of the COs, there are various, like here, for each of the COs, like suppose in this particular program, there are various courses. In this term, in this semester one, the courses are cost and management accounting. Why am I teaching course and cost and management accounting? Because this engineer that I'm going to produce, the management engineer, the management graduate that I'm going to produce, should be able to work in an accounts department and manage the functionality there. Should know, understand the concepts of accounts, should understand what is the balance sheet, should understand ratio analysis, should be able to compare the last year profit or loss and income and expense with this year's. Why am I teaching legal aspect of business? Because in case of any legal dispute, I should be able to keep my points to take me to a win. Why should the student learn production management, human resource management? Because what did my PO say is, my PO said that my person should be managerial and business-wise competent and should understand different management concepts, which are applicable to different departments in a particular organization. So all these programs, all these courses that I have in this program, HR and marketing and production management and legal aspects and cost and management accounting, there are various domains, various departments in an organization. Hence, they do relate to the POs. Now, maybe cost and management accounting doesn't relate to PO4, how a management graduate behaves in the society, but it does relate to PO1, PO2, PO3. PO should be at least 10 to 12 in number. This is just a sample. So all of these LOs here are defined, learning outcomes for a particular course, or you can also define it as a course outcome are defined. And from this also, like, should be able to understand. This can relate to Bloomberg's taxonomy. Should be able to prepare. This is creation relating to Bloomberg's taxonomy. By applying the accounting concept, this is application. This is creation. This is interpretation. That means understanding. This is analysis. See, I can pick up this Bloomberg's taxonomy and see how does it relate to the different taxonomies that I have. Should to understand and to appreciate. So, okay, understand means I'm just talking about remembering and understanding. So depending upon what kind of ability I want the student to derive from this particular course, I need to define my COs in a proper manner. That's very, very important. I also define topics and subtopics and course outlines. So let me give you an example for that. So please feel free to ask if you have any questions. I'm just going on and on because I'm just trying to, yeah. 1 minute, yeah. I'll just open up one more screen to just give you an example of how does it relate. I can show you here only. Yeah. I missed it out, but I can show you here. Yeah. So here, if you see, this is the course outline for a particular course. So what is the course description? Course management, this is course outline mandated by NAC. It's a course file that I'm showing you. In order to prepare for a career in the facet of business world, an understanding of global issues is critical. This is again relating to Bloomberg's taxonomy. Studying international business with help student prepare for diverse business opportunities. So what is the course description? Is it aligning with what am I aiming for? What are the learning objectives? Gain understanding and appreciation. Develop knowledge for comparative analysis or for preparing financial statements. That is creation. So all of this definition, and then going to the details of topics and subtopics. What will I do in overview of cost and management accounting? So it's just an introduction. So just remembering and understanding part. So here, ascertainment of cost and cost accounting. So here, maybe I will delve deep and I will explain material cost. Am I giving any? So here, I'm just showing that objectives of and scope of cost and management accounting. So I'm just showing what is the scope here that I'm going to cover. So methods of costing. So definitely some methods I'll be learning, and maybe I will do some comparative analysis on these methods. So this topic, subtopics, etc., all of that will be analyzed with the help of Bloomberg's taxonomy. Which taxonomy am I using? What am I intending? What is my intention behind teaching this course? And is that intention met with whatever overview and topics, subtopics that I have decided? Or am I, you know, diverting somewhere? How will I assess this particular course? These are the assessment parameters that I'm using for this particular course only, for cost and management accounting. Case assignments, case analysis, attendance, assignments, case study, presentation. So it's mostly, it's mostly cases, case driven. So that means people are forced to think. People are forced to participate. People are forced to derive conclusions, not remember and write things. Or not do comparative analysis, probably. I'm not sure, just mentioning it. So that is how a course file, everything will be analyzed with the help of OBE. Now here, yeah. So here, once I have defined this course outcomes, every possible assignment that I give here, suppose I give this assignments, I will be doing quizzes and attendance and class participation and assignments and group assignments, every single assignment that I give, so this particular assignment, how to identify solutions for managing cost accounting, is mapping with all the four course outcomes, LO1, LO2, LO3, and LO4. Do I also want to map this question to a particular topic so that I know which all Bloomberg's taxonomy that I'm addressing? So each question in every assignment, each question in every online test, I can map to particular course outcomes, which in turn will map to the program outcomes. So I will show you that mapping also just now. Also, maybe this particular question will be attempted by only 5 students or 50% students or maybe 100% students. And on an average, their score is 60%. So I would know how much of LO1, LO2, LO3 is achieved. How much is attained already? So just let me show you the mapping of CU and PO. So these are the CUs that I have defined, learning outcomes of the course. POs I have already shown you. So the learning outcomes mapped with the 4 POs, the first learning outcome only helps me achieving the PO1 outcome, not the PO2, PO3, PO1 and PO4. And it relates at a high degree. What is the high degree meaning? High degree meaning here they have defined between 60% to 100%. Medium is 40% to 60%. And low is less than 40%. I can define 5 degrees also. These are different levels. So how does each learning outcome relate to the program outcome? If I can derive the attainment of LO1, I can derive part attainment of PO1. And LO1 is also contributing to the attainment of PO4. So automatically all the calculations will happen on its own. So here in class participation, 10 marks, this particular student scored this much. And all of this, these are the scores. So I will show you how the attainment will be calculated here. So now this is, the calculation is already done. I will show you how the calculation was done. But here the PO attainments have been like this. This particular PO attainment has been like 3 was the highest level, but I've been able to achieve 2.8. What was the LO? Students should be able to understand the importance of accounting concepts. So accounting concept importance students have understood. What else have the students understood? Students have understood this, to how much they have understood. What, this is low. This is medium. This is really low. Low attainment. But this is not the end of it. This is actually multiple different courses, course outcomes will contribute to the attainment of POs, and total calculation will happen in that manner. Now let me show you the evaluation sheet. So in class participation 1, there was only one question. So maybe one case study could have floated, which was relating to the outcomes LO1, LO2 and LO3. And these are the scores of the students. Now, when they calculate the scores of the students, number of students above the satisfaction level, number of students who appeared, and the percentage of CO attained. So here, number of students appeared 5, but only 4 are above the satisfaction level. So 80% attainment they have calculated for this particular question. So like that, different attainments can be calculated, and this is all automated. This is an algorithm which is in place, which works perfectly well, and gives you all possible, you know, all possible understanding. So now let me show you a very, very interesting example here, just to give you an overview of the whole thing. One minute, yeah. So I've just logged in. This is a local server and I was doing some experiments here. So first of all, this particular faculty is teaching these courses. These courses, full forms are given here, whatever courses she's teaching. Now in this courses, this is a dashboard that I'm showing you. Has she defined the course outcomes? Has she defined the CO to PO mapping? Is the evaluation schema defined or not? Is the marks uploaded or not? Is the session plan in place? Is the course outcome to curriculum mapping done? Is the course curriculum defined? So all of this, this is a charter that gives me that the faculty is teaching 4 particular courses and what all steps are done or not done. And I'm also showing you the complete report of how to look at everything in totality. So if you look at everything in totality, then this particular institution, ABC Institute of Technology, this is a test server. So this is all test data. This is a vision, mission, core values and goals that the person, that the institution has. This particular institution has two programs running, MTech Data Science and MBA. These two programs are run, having this individual vision, mission, core values, and goals. Now, let me talk about this MTech Data Science program. This program has 4 semesters, batch strength. Is there a question? I just heard a ping, so I will just check once. One moment. Sorry, I'm on Chrome.
Yeah, ma'am, the what Professor Sudhakaran has typed this informative session, madam, we need PPT and material belongs to presentation.
Yeah, I will and, share.
Yeah, another request from Vishal, sir. Yeah. In continuous sheet of practical, if any practical is mapped with 2 course outcomes, for example, student can score 8 marks out of 10 in that practical, then how can we bifurcate 8 marks in the column of 2 course outcomes?
Yeah, so let me answer this question. One is just sharing the material, which I will do. Another is, now let's say you're saying defined a practical exam. You have defined a practical exam. Now in this practical exam, first of all, how many questions was there only one question or there were multiple questions? Suppose there were 3 questions. The first question was, let's say, of 4 marks, and the second question was of 4 marks, and the third question was of 2 marks, and student has scored 8 marks. So let's say 3 here and 3 here and 2 here. And this particular question was actually relating to LO1 and LO2. This particular question was relating to LO1 and LO3. This particular question was relating to, let's say, LO2 and LO5. Let's see. I will. Will not see of leads to 2 courses, or how many courses? So depends upon how. And then this particular question has scored 3 out of 4. This particular student has scored 3 out of 4. What has other students scored? How many students have attempted this question? So average of all that will determine how much percentage of LO1 has been achieved and how much percentage of LO2 has been achieved. Also, LO1 calculation from question 1 plus LO1 calculation from question 2 plus LO1 calculation from another question which was in an online test, plus LO1 calculation from another case study, which was also part of continuous assessment. So LO1 can be related to multiple questions in various continuous evaluation. From everywhere, LO1 attainment average will determine actually how much of LO1 was achieved, and how much of LO2 was achieved, and how much of LO3, LO4, and LO5 was achieved. That is how the calculation is done. And for that, Vishal, I will give you a link which you can actually read, and then you will be able to understand the complete algorithm. But this is not only one student's attainment. We calculate the whole crowd. What is the average attainment from this question and from any other question, whichever relates to LO1? Like that. Okay, so I will explain you more of this. Just give me a minute. I'm showing you that example only. Yeah. Where am I now? Here.
Ma'am, his question is like, if one question is mapped to two LOs, then how to bifurcate that particular mark? So his question was, for in an experiment, a student gets 8 out of 10. And that experiment is mapped to two LOs, say LO1 and LO2. So 8 out of 10, that means 80% attainment is given for both LO1 as well as LO2, or is there...
LO2, but let's say LO1 was, related to this question one in a medium way, and LO2 was related to this question one in a high way. I showed you the levels, right? Low, medium, and high. So then that percentage of here 60%, how much of the relation is that? So whether it has to be multiplied by 1 or 2 or 3 will also play a part. And that is how the calculation will be done. So yeah, 80% for this student is okay. But it's not that 80% of LO1 and LO2 both are achieved. LO2 80% achieved because it's highly related to, this particular question is highly related to LO2, but LO1 relation is medium. So that averaging will also happen. So I'll come into more details of this. Do not worry. I'll show you more of it. Now here I was talking about this in this particular program, MTech Data Science, there are 4 semesters. There's only one batch. These are the POs and the PEOs defined, and the number of courses, 6. There couldn't be many actually. Now I'm going to the PO and POs defined. So these are the POs defined for this particular program, MTech in Data Science. Acquire in-depth knowledge of concept, all of this. Develop algorithm, develop appropriate algorithm, apply statistical data, demonstrate knowledge, understand the professional ethics. So you see, if you read this now and you remember those Bloomberg's taxonomy, everything relates. So here, analyze, understand, analyze, apply, evaluate, remember, create, understand. Which all Bloomberg's taxonomy are applicable, automatically the algorithm will figure out. Now let me find out the attainment. Now how did this attainment come? I'll just show you how the course attainment is calculated and then I'll come back here. So Vishal, hang on. I'll just explain this in more details. Now here, this PO and PO attainment, this is just, I'm just showing you the report that PO1 has been attained 71.67%, and this calculation is only through direct assessment. Indirect assessment, some feedback was taken. So that was indicating 76% attainment. So average attainment was 71.33% attainment, and so on and so forth. Now here, suppose I want to go into the details of this. So this particular PO1 was relating to many COs across the program. So CO12, CO22, CO31, CO33. How was it related? Medium manner or high manner? If it's medium manner, then it has to be multiplied by a weightage of 2, otherwise 1, otherwise 3, like that. And what was the percentage of CO attainment? So you can see this CO22 has, now what is this CO22? Python may learn most widely used Python packages, including NumPy, Panda, Mat, etc., etc. This has been attained only 53.33%. So you can immediately judge that all these packages must not have been very, the students might not have been very comfortable with these packages. They just have general awareness of these packages, probably. How much of this CO has been predictive modeling? So formulation, I mean, they do understand, they can apply, but correct formulation and then decision making, maybe the students are not very good. I am just checking about the CO. Here. Now here, if you see. Now some other PO will have some other COs linked and so on and so forth. Now I'm going back to understanding the COs. So these are the various courses. Actually, courses in a program are much more. They could be 30 courses. But this is just an example data. So I'm going into the details of machine learning. So in machine learning, these are the COs only for machine learning here, for one particular course. This CO is linked with these POs. So everywhere, if you see, what are these POs? PO5 and PO1, hands-on machine learning, and what does it say more? I'll have to zoom in a bit. Concepts and techniques with application, hands-on Python, design data-intensive applications. So all, what are these POs? That information also you will get. Now let me see the attainment of CO11, let's say. So health of CO evaluation. So CO14, how many, I mean, out of all the assessment that I have done, how many questions were relating to CO14? 29.4 means 30%. Here around 25%. CO13 was only 10%. And this one was 40%. Lot of emphasis have been given to CO12 attainment. Many questions were relating to CO12, but less questions were relating to CO13. Now here, CO11 attainment levels. What was CO11? Gain knowledge about basic concepts of machine learning. Overall evaluation 70.78%. Here overall evaluation 70.69%. So number of attainments, average class performance is less than 55 for 15.6, between 55 and 65 for 17.8. This is not the same levels. This is a different setup. So yahan par they have identified different levels. Level 2, average class performance between 65 and 75 and greater than 75. Level 3, 44% people have. Now suppose I go into further details. Then this particular question here, this particular CO11 was relating to these questions in these quizzes and assignments. Which questions? What kind of learning algorithms for facial identities or facial expressions? Which one of the following is not machine learning disciplines? What are the different methods of sequential supervised learning? What was the question to CO weightage? This question was related to the CO with a weightage of 50%. Another one was with a weightage of 60%. Any related Bloomberg taxonomy? Total number of students who appeared? Evaluation overall percentage? How many students scored between this, between this, between this, and less than this? And all the other details. So for each one of them, actually, you can find out which all questions were relating. Now, suppose CO12. What was the weightage? This was highly 100%. It was, this question was trying to relate to this particular CO. But this question was only trying to relate 30% to this particular CO. Now, according to Vishal's question, I will just give you the details here. It's a simple engineering mathematical formula what you're asking, Vishal, and this is a very suitable example, and I will show you the formula how the calculation is being done, so you can actually solve that. So if CO attainment by a student, suppose the student of is scored in question 1 4 marks, question 2 3 marks, question 3 4 marks, question 4 2 marks, how does question 1 relate to which all COs? These all COs with these percentages. So question 1 relates to CO1 30%, relates to CO3 70%, and so on and so forth. A simple formula is given how the average can be calculated. And you can just go through this and find out. So that's a simple formula that I'm not going to explain here. It's a very, very simple, like how mathematical calculations are done, that is done. What has the student attained? So here, if you see, how does it relate to this particular CO? That is also that weightage is also taken, 30%, 25%, whatever it is. So you have to check all of this. So what I'll do, ma'am, is I have gone into a lot of details and I was the only one who was speaking. So I will rather wait for now everybody to ask me questions, because it seems it's more details I've delivered than it was desired. So I will rather.
Yes, and it was very informative. Yeah, participants, if there is any doubts, you can ask.
Yes, I will share the sheet. I will share the calculations with the organizers, and then maybe they will share it with you.
Thank you so much.
Any questions?
Madam, about mapping of projects to the program outcomes.
Correct.
Or rather, do we also map it to COs and then to the program outcomes in our software?
So now, outcome-based education tells me that everything has, whatever you do in the program, has to be mapped. It doesn't leave any exception. It tells me either you map or you don't do it. Do it. Like it says, either you say it and do it, or else you don't say and do not do. It has to be mapped. Why is the project work there? So project work, suppose for BE computers, it's, let's say, you know, a 6 months or a 2 months or a 4 months, you know, industry experience. So what was it for? Was it related to hardware? Was it related to software? So that particular project can be, the COs can be defined either acquiring knowledge in testing domain or in hardware domain or in assembly domain or in software domain. Because a computer engineer can be expected to do either of these. So either of those. Now, so how does it relate to these all? So this particular project will relate to these COs. And these COs will in turn lead to POs. POs will be like making a graduate, engineering graduate who can design solutions. That's one of the graduate attribute. Another graduate attribute can be, he can be creating a software for, you know, mechanizing or for automating a particular department. It leads to that PO also. And then it is possible that out of the lot, 70% students went for the hardware projects. 30% only went for the software project. Or, you know, maybe some machine programming project, 30% went. So which of the objectives we are inclining to in this particular batch, that can be judged. But there is no exception. Be it project, be it anything, field study, everything must relate, must have defined COs, which must relate and contribute to the POs. And there should be no CO which is untouched and no PO which is untouched, for sure.
Yes, yes, madam. And yeah, that there in the software, so that, no, we'll be able to handle that.
Of course. Sir. Yes, yes. So everything you will be able to do through the software, and yes, it will give academic admin and the faculty an idea that what the faculty has not done in a particular course, like he's not defined the COs, he's not defined the topics or subtopics, he's not defined the evaluation parameters, he's not done the evaluation, all reports will come.
Yes, madam. We'll be fortunate to use this platform at our institution.
Yeah, it'll be automated for you, so you don't have to worry. Yeah.
Yes, yes. Over to you, Rita, madam.
Yes. Yeah, if there are no questions, then I take this opportunity to thank madam. Juno is a powerful tool for OBE attainment, and we are fortunate that madam spared valuable time and shared her expertise. Thank you, Dr. Arpita madam, for enlightening us to have a practical outlook on how OBE can be achieved. Thank you for discussing the OBE creator. Yes.
Will you request madam to share stop presentation so that we can give moment to madam virtual moment?
Yes, ma'am has stopped presenting.
So my this thing is visible. The thank you slide.
No, it's not.
You have just to actually share your screen. Yeah.
Thank you for discussing that OBE creates a production line mechanism. How the output is quantified. Stitching together the input, process, and output to improve stakeholder satisfaction in the form of feedback. Based on feedback, we modify the input or process to improve the output. Madam brought out clearly the difference between qualitative and quantitative form of education and how OBE helps to achieve stakeholder satisfaction. Madam brought out the concept of continuous quality improvement. The cycle being, first step is say what you want. Next step is do what you say. Third step is prove it. Fourth step is improve it. And then again, keep on doing it. Madam has brought out the difference between long-term outcomes, which is vision, mission, PEO, and the short-term outcomes, which is PO and CO. Also, we discuss the evaluation parameters, the direct and indirect, and under direct, what all kinds of evaluation mechanisms we can use, and under indirect, what are the mechanisms that are used. Thank you, madam, for highlighting the importance of use of Bloom's taxonomy for evaluation at analysis level, creation level, etc., to groom the students in the right direction. Madam, we are very grateful to you that you gave an interesting overview of Juno tool, using which OBE attainment is achieved, and how to look at everything in totality. We are extremely thankful for this session to you.
Thank you so much. Thanks, everyone.
As a token of our appreciation, we have this memento for you online.
Thank you so much. Yeah. And ma'am, I'll mail on the same link, I'll mail all the material. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Yes.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Yeah.
Yes. Madam, you have some instructions, no, to all of us?
Yeah, thank you, participants, for all the attention that you have given towards the session. And I would like to remind you all that we will be having the photo session in the evening. And you can be in your best dressed form.
Madam, how will you ask us to, take that photograph? I mean,
join back, and we start the session at 5 o'clock, and we have the panel discussion. So we have panel members. We start with the session by introducing the panel members, and after that, immediately we'll go for the photo session. So I will request you all to turn on the camera, and after a count of 1, 2, 3, we will be clicking the picture. Okay, so listen to that 1, 2, 3, and then you will be ready. At the count of 1, 2, 3, then we will take the screenshot. Yeah,
thank you, ma'am. I hope this is clear to everyone, and as we discussed, the same message is passed on. Thank you so much.
Yes. Thank you, and see you all at 5 o'clock.